Recorded Books presents The Magus Conspiracy, Assassin's Creed, The Engine of History, by Kate Heartfield, narrated by Moira Quirk. Dedication for Brent. Prologue. Simeon Price tried to shut out the sound of whispered prayer and the groaning of the ship. He flopped one arm over his ear, but it was no good. He was irritatingly awake. "Seasick again, Halford," he mumbled. The praying stopped.
"Not tonight. Can't sleep is all."
Simeon turned over with some difficulty in his rocking hammock. Private Sawyer Halford was a dark bulk against a line of similar dark bulks, lit up by a single lantern against the wall. The troop deck was stuffy this deep into the night, a stew of sweat and tobacco, iron and wood. Overhead somewhere, a rat scuttled.
"Thinking about what's waiting for us when we go ashore."
Simeon kept his voice low. He'd recently been given the appointment of Lance Corporal, which was hardly even a rank, but it did mean that he had responsibility over Halford and a few other privates of the 74th Highland Regiment of Foot. Anyway, Simeon liked Halford. But going ashore was going to happen, and soon. They had sailed past Cape Town, the captain charting a course that hugged the southern coast of Africa to save time, speeding by steam and sail toward war.
"I suppose so," Halford said. "It was one thing being sent to Ireland. I knew what to expect, or thought I did."
There was a pause, during which they both thought about what they'd seen in Ireland. The houses burned, the children so thin.
"But I'd never even heard of the Kosa before we sailed." "I doubt they've heard of you either, mate."
Halford might have chuckled or might have sighed. It was hard to tell which in the dark.
"At least when my father went off to fight Napoleon, he'd seen a picture of the bastard."
He paused, then said even more quietly,
"I've never killed anyone before."
Neither had Simeon, though he'd come close a couple of times in his father's public house back in Ealing. There had been one night in Tipperary when he had expected to be asked to kill women and old men. In the end, they had left the storehouse he was guarding without violence, gone back to their hungry beds, and Simeon had got very drunk. He had no words of wisdom for Halford tonight.
"I'm sorry I interrupted your prayer," Simeon said quietly. "Prayer?" Halford chuckled. "Oh no, Price, I wasn't praying. I always recite Shakespeare when I can't sleep." "Which bit of Shakespeare?" "It varies. Tonight, it's the Sceptred Isle speech from Richard II.
Simeon was surprised. "Oh, right. England bound in with the triumphant sea whose rocky shore beats back the envious siege of watery Neptune.
I can't remember the next part. It's now bound in with shame, with inky blots and rotten parchment bonds. That England that was wont to conquer others hath made a shameful conquest of itself." Halford paused. "Maybe not the best choice for tonight, but it was the sea that made me think of it."
Simeon opened his mouth to say he thought it was an excellent choice, when the ship lurched to a terrible stop, throwing him half out of his hammock. There were shouts from above. Simeon disentangled his arm and stumbled to his feet. The hideous noise stretched on. A sickening crunch, the iron hull tearing open, the floor tilted from bow to stern. Simeon lurched through the jungle of hammocks and ropes past the bewildered men just waking up, out to the door and the stairs up to the deck in his shirt and trousers. It was a warm night, with cold stars above, the dark water below. The ship was now unnaturally still and lying at an odd angle. HMS Birkenhead was a Frankenstein's monster of iron and wood, converted from a frigate to a troop ship, steam coming from its great black funnel and sails furled on its masts, paddle wheels on its sides. There were men shouting up on the forecastle.
"She ran onto a fucking rock,"
said a passing sailor in uniform, seeing Simeon's face. "There was a light on shore that we thought was a lighthouse, but it must have been a fire. We're on the wrong course. The rock put a bloody great gash in the bow and we're stuck fast."
"All right," said Simeon,
as the sailor seemed to be looking for some kind of resolution from someone.
"Where are we needed? On the pumps?"
"Not yet. They're firing the engines to back us off the rock."
"But won't that bring more water in?"
The sailor shrugged.
"Captain's orders. We have to get free," he says. "Says the compartments will hold."
As if in answer, the ship came to life and heaved slowly backwards. Shouts from the front and the bow dipped, throwing Simeon back the way he'd come. As he righted himself, he turned toward the stairs and saw the water rising, covering the bottom of the stairwell. Those stairs led back down to the upper troop deck, where hundreds of men had been sleeping minutes before. He slipped and slid down the stairs into the water, wet up to his knees. The door had swung shut behind him, or he'd closed it. He couldn't recall now. Someone was pulling at it from the inside, and he shoved and nearly fell onto Private Halford, soaked to the skin and panting.
"There are wounded,"
Halford said, and pointed back behind him toward the bow. Simeon and Halford waded, the ship tilting and throwing them onto each other as they tripped and slid. The deck, which had been built as a gunroom before the ship's conversion, was full of men, all in their nightshirts and frantically crowding to the door that led to freedom. The ship's engines were as silent as death now, and the water as cold. The fires must have gone out. And all the while Simeon was thinking, "There's another deck below this one. Where's the water coming in?" A man had hurt his leg, probably broken, and was trying to keep his head above water as he staggered, the ship still shuddering beneath them and the water as full of waves as though they were wind inside the ship. Simeon and Halford put their arms around the man's shoulders and got him to the door. Someone yelled,
"Lance Corporal Price, you're needed!"
Simeon craned his neck back to see. Up on the deck at the top of the steep stairs, a young lieutenant with a frantic expression. Lieutenant Grimes, that was his name.
"The horses!"
Grimes shouted down. "We cut them free, but they're thrashing and kicking up here. We can't get anything done until we get them overboard. It's bedlam. Look lively!" Simeon pushed wet hair out of his eyes.
"The horses are on deck, but the men..." "The men, unlike the horses, will stay quiet," the lieutenant snapped.
Grimes was in the 74th Regiment, the same as Simeon. Where was Colonel Seaton? Off doing something useful, presumably, which left men like Grimes free rein to issue orders. Out of nowhere, someone slammed Lieutenant Grimes roughly down to the boards. The figure wore a cloak, with a hood so close around his face that all Simeon could see was a square jaw, unshaven. Not a uniformed soldier, whoever he was, but he held an axe. He descended the stairs at speed.
"Come on,"
the figure growled, pushing past Simeon toward the lower deck and the rising water.
"Is he?"
Simeon tried to see what had happened to the lieutenant.
"I haven't killed him yet, which might prove a mistake."
Simeon was stunned. Cloaked men didn't appear out of nowhere on Her Majesty's troop ships, and they certainly didn't knock officers down. But there was no time for questions. Whoever the stranger was, he was heading down toward the muffled shouts and screams. The water in the lower stairwell was blacker than the sky above. They had to pull themselves down with the water over their heads. The door to the men's quarters wouldn't open. The stranger beat at the door with the axe, but the water slowed his movement. Eventually, he resorted to a kind of scraping and slashing. When the wood of the door split, Simeon pushed his hands in and pulled the door apart, he and the stranger working at it until the door was splintered open and their hands were bloody and there was no air in their lungs. Then Simeon started to black out. He lost his grip and floated to the middle of the stairwell and hardly knew whether he was drowning or not. Somewhere, High overhead, yellow light from the ship's lantern swam in his eyes. His head was free of the water as he grabbed for the steep stairs. Then the cloaked man was at his side, pushing a coughing and spluttering soldier up into the air. Simeon was shaking from cold and panic. He seemed to have to think about every breath. But the cloaked man was going back below, pulling himself down the thin stair rail. Who was this bloke anyway? A stowaway? A paying passenger? A sailor out of uniform? There would be time to think about that later. Now, every moment was a life lost or saved, and Simeon had enough air in his lungs to do his part. Simeon took a deep breath and followed the stranger back down into darkness. They found one more man thrashing, trying to get through the broken doorway in a panic. The stranger battered at the door, and this time it opened. They pulled him out and up. Their third descent found a man floating limp, halfway between floor and ceiling, and they pulled him out too, pushing his nightshirt off his unconscious face. The stranger rolled him to one side and then the other, shaking him, shouting at him, and pushing on his abdomen. But it was very clearly no good. As Simeon and the stranger lay on the stairs, retching and coughing, a dead man lying beside them, the cloaked man gasped, "Go on! You don't want to survive this just to be court-martialed." A memory leapt into Simeon's mind. It had only been weeks ago, but it felt like years. The hot sun beating down as all of the 600 troops on board the Birkenhead were paraded to watch a young stoker receive his 50 lashes, punishment for leaping overboard and swimming for the coast of Sierra Leone, punishment for desertion.
"What about you?"
Simeon croaked, his throat aching and tight from their trips underwater.
"I don't answer to them," said the man, pushing back his hood.
Simeon didn't recognize him. A middle-aged man with light brown skin, sharp cheekbones, and a few days' worth of beard on his angular chin. He was panting, his hand to his chest.
"But you took the Queen's shilling, didn't you? So go on. There's no one left to save down here."
The stranger stared sidelong at him, as if it were a dare. Beneath the battered cloak, he didn't look any more soldierly. He must be a stowaway, although for what reason Simeon couldn't dream. And why was he risking capture, not to mention his life, to save the men everyone else seemed to have given up for lost? What would happen to him if he went up on deck?
"I don't know who you are, and for the moment I don't care. But I want to know you'll be safe," Simeon said. "Can you make it to the boat? Come on, we'll go together and I'll make sure no one gets in your way."
The man's face contorted into a smile.
"Maybe he was right about you," he muttered.
"Who was?"
"Listen, if you ever find you want to give the Queen back her shilling, make your way to Vienna. You'll find us there, a brotherhood that believes in taking orders from conscience alone. Nothing is true, everything is permitted. Will you remember that?"
Vienna? It seemed as unreal as fairyland. They were on a sinking ship on the far side of Africa. He seemed unlikely to set foot on land ever again, and if he did, it would be a country where he'd never been before. Even if they survived the night, the 74th Regiment was meant to fight and die for British settlers in their attempt to subjugate the local people. A brotherhood that believed in fairyland indeed. Simeon wasn't sure what to make of any of the stranger's instructions, except that it was too long a speech for a man to make if he was in danger of dying. He nodded briefly, not sure what he was agreeing to. The whole encounter seemed unreal, but everything was unreal at the moment. The screams of the dying, the water gurgling and frothing through every crack in the ship, the stink of wet coal and vomit and tar. Lieutenant Grimes was still roaring commands above. He had work to do and more people to help. The horses would be frantic, and Simeon was still a soldier. Simeon shook the stranger's hand in thanks and farewell, then scrambled up the steep, wet stairs, suddenly dog-tired. The ship was rocking wildly, the mast swinging from one star to another. There was Private Halford, looking as worn out as Simeon felt. Grimes was nowhere to be seen for the moment. A few men were running from one part of the ship to another without any apparent logic to their movements. Others, like Halford, seemed to be stunned, unsure what to do.
"The horses," Simeon said weakly. "I've got orders to see to the horses."
"Already overboard and swimming to shore. If the sharks don't get them, they'll be better off than any of us."
"What's next, then? The boats?"
Halford shook his head glumly.
"They want us to pump. 50 men are to go until they tire. Then the next 50.
"But surely. We got the women and children into the cutter and launched it. That's done, at least."
In the rush to save the drowning down below, Simeon hadn't thought about the officers' wives near the stern of the ship and their children. There must have been a few dozen, all told. A couple of the women had given birth on the journey. Halford continued.
"We tried to get the bigger boats down into the water. Rusted winches and rotten ropes. The boats are no good to us. That's the long and short of it. Can't get two of them off the ship with the winches busted, and the third was swamped when the rope broke."
"No good at all?"
Simeon was shocked. Dozens of people, maybe hundreds, could have fitted into those boats.
"The rest of us, we're to stay on board and pump out the water."
Halford paused.
Do you think that's what we should do?"
Simeon tried to think. He was wet and cold and couldn't seem to stop his shoulders from shaking. The ship juddered backward and there was an all too familiar crunch and scream of iron against stone, a crack of wood breaking. The ship tipped backward this time as water rushed into a fresh hole, this one in the stern. Captain Salmon strode toward them, the way only a sea captain can stride on the watery deck of a swaying ship. His dark hair was wild and so were his dark eyes.
"She's going down," he said. "Anyone who can swim for it, do so."
With an aye-aye or two, a few men scrambled to find a place to jump overboard. Halford and Simeon climbed up to the poop deck and clung to the railing. The unbalanced ship was rocking wildly. Sometimes the sea was a few feet away and sometimes it was a great deal further. The prospect of diving was terrifying. But the captain was right. If they stayed on board, the suction of the ship as it went down would pull them under, or they'd be caught in the rigging and they'd have no chance of swimming to shore or surviving long enough to be rescued. They climbed the railing as if it were a ladder, and Simeon considered stripping off his wet clothing. It would be a terrible sunburn on the coast of the Cape, if he made it that far. Instead, he tucked his shirt well into his trousers to keep the thing from billowing and dragging in the water.
"Beat to quarters!"
came a scream from behind them.
"Beat to quarters!"
They turned to see Lieutenant Grimes and all the surviving men, half of them in uniform and half in their shirts, standing as steady as they could on the tilting deck.
"You took the Queen's shilling," the stranger had said. Simeon had wanted to become anonymous, to make a quiet living, one man in a crowd. It was either north to Manchester and a factory, or off to the army, and the army had seemed less likely to result in injury. He'd wanted to stop thinking, to stop making all the wrong decisions, to stop making any decisions at all. But under the stars of the far side of the world, on a breaking ship full of the newly drowned, Simeon found himself saying,
"The captain's orders were to swim for it." "And I say, beat to quarters, damn you!"
The lieutenant took a few unsteady steps to them and spoke quietly, almost intimately, as though showing the great patience he had for this insubordinate lance corporal. "If these men swim, they'll swim to the 2 lifeboats out there, which are full of women and children. They'll try to get into the boats and they'll swamp them. Or," Simeon said through gritted teeth, "they won't do that because they aren't monsters. If they swim, they have a chance." The lieutenant whirled on his heel and yelled, "Feet to quarters! Stand firm and stand for Her Majesty! Men, you can be proud of this moment. You have carried out your orders calmly. All has been done with the utmost regularity." Orford slid down off the rail and followed the lieutenant toward the ranks of men, who were indeed standing in silence, dripping and staring. "The utmost regularity," repeated the lieutenant, and then the ship broke in half. It sounded like a cannon and felt like an earthquake. The great black funnel came crashing down, right on top of several men, including Private Horford. Simeon ran forward, but as he reached for Horford, the private's body skidded down the rocking deck, coming to rest at the lieutenant's feet. Dead eyes stared up at the officer. Blood poured from his lifeless head. Horford wouldn't have a chance to worry about killing a man. All of the shouts and groaning had stopped. The only men left alive were holding on and staring at each other. The world was silent for a moment. "Beat to quarters!" screamed the lieutenant again, as the two halves of the ship slipped and groaned, each in its own direction, down toward the sea. Men grabbed for the yardarm, for the masts, for anything. "Beat to quarters!"
Chapter 1.
All around the hippodrome, golden gaslights framed the indigo sky. Pierrette loved the early evenings, when humans and gods seemed to be competing for who could dazzle the night. Let them do their utmost. Pierrette was about to give them all a run for their money. Tonight, she'd perform the troupe's most dangerous and astonishing act. She wasn't exactly grateful that the usual performer had broken his collarbone and declared he was done with circus life for good. Still, if this was her chance, she was ready to seize it. Major Wallen was not convinced, though. Even now, when the band had started up and the stands were filled. They were always filled. The new hippodrome in Kensington Gardens was only a few steps away from the imposing Crystal Palace, housing the great exhibition, filled with wonders from all over the world. There had never been a better place or time to be a performer than London in the summer of 1851. There was so much demand that the hippodrome had several troupes performing. The long oval ring had only just been swept of ostrich dung and chariot wheel ruts from the afternoon's astonishing antiquity performance when a fresh audience streamed in for the horse show. But Major Wallen, the leader of the Aurora Equestrian Troupe, looked nervous. He stood under the performer's entrance in his crisp blue and gold jacket, a simulacrum of the Swedish cavalry officer's uniform he had worn in his former life. He regarded Pierrette with scepticism. "You know that I can do it," she said, speaking in French as she always did with Major Wallen. "I've done it a dozen times in rehearsal."
"But everyone would be expecting a man."
Major Wallen scratched one of his greying mutton chops.
"Mazeppa is always performed by a man. It only makes sense for a man, because the character in Byron's poem was lashed to the galloping horse as punishment for an affair with a countess. You cannot play that part."
"You don't think people will believe I could seduce a countess?" Pierrette put her hand on her hip. Her one-piece costume, which Nell had hastily constructed that day for the Mazeppa role, was the same pinkish hue as her skin. She was teasing, and he blushed. The Swedish major and his late Italian wife, the Aurora, who had given her name to the troupe, had taken Pierrette with them when they left France 3 years previously, in the wake of the bloody Paris uprising when her parents were killed. Major Wallen had been a second father to her, and she respected his judgment. He was the master of all the horses, and he made every call. But Pierrette was nearly 19 now, old enough to know her own mind, and she knew she could do this and make it the talk of the town. She needed to do this. Her destiny lay in the lights, in the air. There was no way the world could see her talents if she only did what every other equestrian did. The somersaults, the standing on bareback, the vaults. All of it was dangerous, and all of it took a great deal of skill. But people wanted more. They wanted drama. They wanted a story. They wanted baying wolves and growling thunder and a galloping horse foaming and frenzied, or at least made to look like it was. Dear old Attila would be fine. She needed an act that would make the world take notice. She smiled fondly at the major and said,
Mazeppa hasn't really been about the poem for years. He's about tying someone to a horse and having that horse gallop into rocks and be chased by wolves and up the ramp. Imagine how our troops' reputation will soar when people hear that a woman has performed Mazeppa. And with my hoop act at the end to fetch my trophy, it will be different to any Mazeppa ever performed.
The major grumbled.
There is something to be said for tradition. We are not mere spectacle. We are artists.
But this was a speech he'd given enough times to bore even himself, and he was looking out at the crowd.
The tradition is that someone performs Mazeppa at the end of the show. Everyone will expect it, and I am the only member of this troupe qualified to perform it tonight.
He'd lost, and he knew it. He sighed and said as one last salvo,
I promised your parents I'd keep you safe. Mazeppa is the opposite of safe.
But Pierrette had a salvo ready of her own. She tucked one of her dark curls behind her ear and quoted two lines from Byron's poem, in English.
No matter, I have bared my brow full in death's face. Before and now.
The brass band's music went low, the horns quiet and the drums suspenseful. The evening's entertainment began. First up was the African Hercules, who was really Hugh Robinson from Manchester, riding two horses around the ring, a foot on each saddle. Beside Pierrette, Hugh's wife watched from the wings, her arms folded over her neat blue bodice with its pearl buttons. Nell Robinson was the troop's accountant and business manager. More than once, Major Wallen had asked her to perform, but she'd said she had seen too many black women dressed in skimpy furs as femme sauvage to consider it, and always refused to talk about it any more than that. Then it was the rope dancer, the beautiful and lithe Ariel Fine, billed as neither man nor woman but sprite of the air, performing intricate steps on a somewhat slack rope with a balance bar in their hands. The music took on a military air for Tilly Wallen, the major's 8-year-old daughter, on her pretty mare. She always charmed the audience with her blonde curls, and she could perform as well as any adult Pierrette had seen. The major was so proud of his daughter and had trained her in the careful manoeuvres and jumps of the haute école tradition. Jovita Ferreira, a Brazilian woman who'd left her husband and literally run away to the circus, performed Pierrette's usual act of somersaults, vaults and Amazonian feats. Then it was Pierrette's turn. Mechanical covers rose up to dim the flames of the gaslights as she strode out into the ring. Major Wallen tied her to Attila's broad back, and there she was, staring up at the darkening sky. They hadn't told the audience there was a change in performer tonight, and whispers went up in the front row as the lights went bright again. Pierrette Arnaud was about to show the world what she could do. She was Mazeppa, the poetic hero, condemned to a terrible journey across Eastern Europe. First, Attila picked his way through a course of rocks made of plaster. Then out came the dogs to chase him, although they were good friends of Attila's now. The brass band did its best imitations of wolves and wild horses as Attila raced three times around the ring. The poem, which she had read purely to find an argument for the major, whispered in her mind. The skies spun like a mighty wheel. I saw the trees like drunkards reel. But there were no trees inside the hippodrome, only a fair few actual drunkards. They were the greatest danger, because the Mazeppa Act required the performer to ride quickly up a ramp that they'd put right over a section of the seating, sacrificing a few tickets to create a thrill. Being so close to the audience, there was always the danger of someone pulling at the ropes or grabbing the performer's leg. It was, in fact, safest to go as quickly as the horse could go, and Attila knew his business. He carried Pierrette confidently on the final run across the dirt toward the ramp, but he was sweating, and so was Pierrette. Even London was hot in July. She could feel herself slipping inside the ropes. If she got tangled in his gait, or he faltered and fell, she could be crushed. Performers had been dragged to their deaths before now. Out of the corner of her eye, Pierrette scanned for any likely troublemakers in the stands. There was a woman holding an opera glass in her hands, and a man over her shoulder looking at the woman. A pickpocket, probably, but too far off to cause Attila and Pierrette any concern. Up, up, and she took her last look at the purpling sky in the centre of the open hippodrome. She could not manage the horse at all, not in this position, sprawled on his back with her legs and arms pinioned. But the people were cheering. It was a roar in her ears. And then Attila reared, Pierrette lurched backward, and the audience gasped. It was all part of the show, a way for Attila to come to a stop and get his carrot. In the darkness, just behind the curtain hanging from the roof that covered the stands, Tilly fed Attila his treat. Major Wallen sliced the ropes and Pierrette emerged back into her adoring gaslight, stumbling because her character had been broken and was waking from a faint, and stumbling because she'd just been untied from the back of a leaping horse. She had three breaths to recover her equilibrium so she could perform the last part of the act, receiving a trophy from a beautiful woman. The audience reacted first to Pierrette, staggering, free and alive, and then across to the beautiful woman in question, who was Jovita in a new costume, lowered in a hoop that hung from a high crane that the apprentices had wheeled out into the centre of the hippodrome. Jovita was high in the air, out of reach, but there was a series of hoops on cranes, and Pierrette would swing on each until, dangling from her knees on the last one, she would catch the trophy as Jovita threw it in mid-air. Another hoop descended from the roof over the stands at the base of the ramp. Her heart beat with joy as she staggered down the ramp. She loved this part. Off to her right, the woman with the opera glass now had four men around her, and they were all turning to her. She was nearly obscured by their broad shoulders and bowler hats. Four men. That wasn't pickpockets. Focus, Pierrette ordered herself and ran down the ramp toward her hoop. At the last moment, she leaped up, caught it in her hands. Now she had to get the hoop moving. A series of climbs and twists hanging from the hoop as it started to swing. Then on to the next hoop and the next. Finally, she dropped to her knees, keeping her eyes on Jovita and the trophy. The final moment was nearly here. And the man behind the woman with the opera glass now had his gloved hand over her mouth, and she was wriggling, her eyes alarmed, her arms restrained, no sign of the opera glass now. They started moving her through the stands, but backward, and nobody around her seemed to be paying any attention. Or they didn't care. Help her! Pierrette wanted to scream. The woman would be out of the audience altogether in a moment, taken by these men for who knows what purpose. All eyes were on Pierrette, except her own. If she was the only witness, well then, so be it. She was the only one who could help. Instead of turning to catch the trophy, Pierrette leapt back to where she'd started, hoop by hoop, and then dangled from her knees over the audience, as they reached up to her, unable to touch her, shouting their praise. She was almost low enough. She could do this. She swung the hoop sideways again and again, back and forth, turning it into a pendulum. A little more and she'd be nearly over the abducted woman. Down to her ankles, looping her feet to hold herself steady, she reached down and grabbed the woman by her arms. It never would have worked if it weren't for the fact that the men around her were so startled by this phenomenon that they slackened their grip and ducked as though from an aggressive seagull. Under her wide green skirt and yellow cape, the lady was a tiny, bony thing. Even so, the weight was too much, and she made it worse by kicking and squirming. Pierrette's ankles were screaming. Her body was contorting in all the wrong ways. A few more seconds was all she had. As the hoop swung backwards, its arc shortened now, she dropped the woman onto the ramp where she and Attila had galloped a few moments before. Pierrette dropped beside her, skinning her knee and jarring her wrists, but the lady was sprawled face first. Pierrette glanced up at Jovita, still high in her hoop, frozen in a dramatic posture, the trophy forgotten in her hand. Her eyes were wide, and her other hand gripped the hoop so hard it was rotating. Everyone in London these days knew that it was pointless asking for help from the police. Most of them were in cahoots with various gangs and criminals, and there was no telling which ones were the good ones at a glance. Anyway, there were no bobbies to be seen in the Hippodrome that night, good or otherwise. But there were four men who seemed determined to get their hands on this woman. So Pierrette took the woman's arm and whispered, "Run!" and lifted her to her feet. She didn't need to say it again. The scrawny lady ran like a frightened cat, gathering strength from who knows where, her skirts in her hands and her heeled shoes slipping on the runway, down into the ring, across to the performer's entrance and out of the Hippodrome. And whether out of some performer's instinct for a dramatic ending, or because she didn't seem very likely to get to safety on her own, Pierrette ran with her. They tore past the rope barrier that kept people without tickets from getting close enough to see inside the Hippodrome. People milled beyond those ropes, out for the evening in the shadow of the great exhibition. Men and women, some well-dressed, but most with worn shawls and patched coats, some with children on their shoulders, little dogs yipping on leashes. The lady ran into the crowd, tripped, and collapsed in a heap of bottle-green poplin. Pierrette snatched up the lady's bonnet just before a dachshund could, then helped her to her feet. The people around them were murmuring, gasping, smiling, confused, a mixture of reactions on every face. Someone said, "Is it part of the trick?" Pierrette turned and smiled at the man. "I'll get my trophy yet, by gum." At that, everyone around her laughed. She knew her English was a bit accented, and that was probably part of what they were laughing at. But that didn't matter. She was who she was, and she would use all of it with every audience until they shouted her name, stamped their feet, whistled and clapped. Pierrette glanced behind. There was a man in a bowler walking toward them with purpose, but whether it was one of the abductors, she couldn't say. And there was a roar from the crowd back in the Hippodrome. But in reaction to what? Maybe Jovita and the others had found some way to make it all look intentional. Maybe Pierrette's performance wouldn't be thought a total disaster. All the same, Pierrette wasn't looking forward to seeing the look on Major Wallin's face. Cursing herself for not leaving well enough alone, Pierrette ducked down by the lady on the ground. "Come, just a little further." She pulled her to her feet one more time, and they walked over mostly green rolling ground toward the Crystal Palace. In the evening, it was lit like a fairy palace. Pierrette had been inside three times already, and had seen a lump of rock billing itself as the Koh-i-Noor, to which she had said, if that was a diamond, she could be anything she wanted. Tonight, she had no desire to pay the shilling admittance, or to walk through the crowds in her skimpy, flesh-coloured maillot. But there was a line of hansom cabs on the road on the far side of the Crystal Palace. She asked the lady,
"Have you got money? For a hansom cab, I mean. As you can see, I have no pockets at the moment."
The lady grimaced as though she was in pain. She had probably hurt herself in the scramble. She was older than Pierrette, in her 30s at a guess, and very thin.
"There's no need," the lady said, her voice clear and determined. "I'll have no trouble reaching my house on foot. It's just on the other side of the park."
Pierrette frowned. Hyde Park could take a half an hour or more to walk through. She couldn't let the lady walk alone, but Major Wallin and the others would wonder what had happened to her. As if in response to the frown, the lady said breathlessly,
"No, you've done enough. I'm quite used to walking on my own. Thank you for your help tonight. You will call on me, won't you? I'm the Countess of Lovelace, Ada, to my friends. I think it's right that you and I should be friends. That poem you performed tonight, Miss Eppa, it was written by my father."
Pierrette had met people before who thought they were Napoleon or Wellington or both at once. But she believed Ada. There were the clothes, for one thing. But also, there was the man in the bowler again, walking in a straight line toward this corner of the park, with his coat flaring, his eyes on them.
"I won't let you walk through the park alone, Lady Lovelace," she said. "The show is finished for tonight anyway. We must hurry."
Pierrette imagined the map of Hyde Park in her head, a great green rectangle in the midst of London. The Crystal Palace, home of the Great Exhibition, was in the middle, along the southern edge. That was on their right now. Beyond it lay busy, bright streets, which might be safer. But if Lady Lovelace was trying to get to the northeast corner, it would be much faster to go diagonally through the park. That meant crossing the bridge over the Serpentine, the lake that cut the park in half. She pulled Ada to the left, urgently, taking a gravel side path. As they approached the Serpentine, Pierrette looked back. There was the shadowy man, and he'd been joined by another, loping along beside him like a hound.
"Bon de salut," Pierrette grumbled, then louder to Lady Lovelace. "Who are these men and why are they so persistent?"
"Creditors," Ada said, out of breath. "I assume, anyway. I do have rather a few debts, you see. I have a wonderful plan. I can guess the horse races, but it hasn't quite worked out. Or I suppose it might be..."
She broke off.
"What?"
"Or they might be someone else," Ada whispered.
At the near end of the bridge stood another two men in bowlers, just at the edge of a circle of light cast by the nearest gas lamp. In the hippodrome, the thugs had counted on the crowd's attention being on the performance. Here in the open, they'd be looking for darkness and isolation. Pierrette took Ada's hand and hurried her toward the path that led to the bridge. They fell in behind a group of three school-aged children following an irritated governess. The children glanced at Pierrette in her pink maillot, but the governess seemed too flustered to care. They were so terribly late and their poor mother would be so worried, her posture announced. Past the men and over the bridge, one of the children ran toward the wooded shore, eager to make friends with a pair of swans. The governess groaned, lifted her skirt and ran after her charge, with the other two following. They were alone and exposed again. Pierrette glanced behind to see four men now, matching their brisk walking pace. They crossed a broad road, the earth packed hard. Pierrette considered taking it north, but there were only occasional carriages on it at the moment, and it was lined with trees that would cut them off from public view. Besides, on the road, they'd be easily bundled into a carriage. They struck out on the footpath leading diagonally across the park. Here the land was open, but it was so dark now. The pursuers were still behind them, and she could see two more men approaching on the path ahead, little more than dark shapes. She looked frantically around. Toward the south, on another path, a couple was strolling arm in arm. Would they help if she called for it? Pierrette pretended to stumble, crying out. Lady Lovelace stopped, but Pierrette waved her concern away. It was a test. The couple on the other path paused, but didn't change course or even turn their heads. The selfishness of some people. The men were closing in.
This way, Pierrette whispered,
and grabbed Lady Lovelace by the elbow. By the time the men were almost within grabbing distance, they were passing the couple. They settled in front of them, still close enough that the man's pipe smoke billowed around them, and slackened their pace. Before long, the odd procession, Pierrette and Lady Lovelace in front, the irritated couple behind, and four men trailing them, passed two more men in bowlers. They might have been the men who'd been approaching on the other path. For a moment, Pierrette wondered whether they might attack all four of them, including the oblivious couple, but the thugs simply touched their hat brims and sneered. The end of the park at last. Ada was walking steadily, one hand on Pierrette's arm. Park Lane was bright and busy, and Pierrette didn't chase after the couple when they took the first opportunity to leave the path. Once there was no sign of the men in the bowler hats, Pierrette risked slowing down for a moment to rest. People walked all around and past them, a sea of silk, felt and beaver hats in all states of repair, shawls smelling of oysters, jackets smelling of beer.
I used to ride out in the park, Ada said with a wistful glance behind them, after they'd caught their breath. Nearly a decade ago now, when I was healthier. Caused quite a scandal as I rode with friends. Men, I mean. But my husband couldn't always go riding with me, and I enjoy riding so much. I'm very good at it. Oh, but of course, not anything like you. Your performance really was marvellous. The demonstration of the principles of motion. I've been wanting to see someone perform Mazeppa since I was a girl.
They walked on, Pierrette's nerves calmed as they approached the marble arch, newly moved to the northeast corner of the park that spring. There was a police station occupying a few rooms inside the arch, and though Pierrette had no intention of involving the police in anything, it might keep Ada's pursuers at bay. Besides, this corner was brightly lit by the gas lamps of Park Lane and Oxford Street. They dodged the wide skirts of fashionable women. A man in a shabby top hat was gesticulating to a crowd, shouting about the glories of Britain's empire. Now that the danger had passed, Pierrette stifled nervous laughter at what she'd done. She had picked up a lady from the audience and deposited her in Park Lane, all while wearing her costume, which was starting to feel very chilly in the night air. Major Wallin would be beside himself. Had poor Jovita come down from her hoop? After they passed the marble arch, Ada lifted one of her bird-thin hands and pointed at one of the tall, dignified brick houses.
Home. William, my husband, is out tonight, but Mother's there. She'll be frantic, of course, once she learns I am not resting in my bedroom as she thinks, but she always forgives me. You must come and see me, my Mazeppa.
She looked Pierrette up and down in her pink maillot and said,
but perhaps not tonight.
Chapter 2.
The daring rescue of a woman from sinister ruffians was all well and good, but it was not exactly a satisfactory ending to the night's performance. The London Evening News suggested the whole thing was a stunt, meant to draw attention to the woman question, whatever that was, by providing a display of sisterly compassion as a more fitting victory for the equestrienne, who, it is said, was not long ago an urchin of Paris. Altogether, the newspapers said, it would have been better to leave well enough alone. Yes, of course, it was all well and good to showcase female talents, but don't call it Mazeppa. Major Wallin, vindicated, hired a male equestrian from Mr. Batty's circus to do Mazeppa. Pierrette was back performing her original act with Jovita. Pierrette smiled in the ring but scowled backstage. An urchin, they'd called her. She had never been anything of the kind. Pierrette Arnaud was the child of Parisian musicians who had been passed over for positions at the Paris Opera due to some slight that Pierrette never fully understood, but that made her father's moustache quiver and his cheeks go red even years later. It wasn't Papa's own talents, he mourned. He was only a passable trumpet player, or so he said. But his wife, he was convinced, could have taken the world by storm with her bowing. No one could bring Vivaldi to life the way Marie Arnaud did. The spotlight was her due. She should have graced every stage in Europe. Instead, because of a petty weasel who always went unnamed, Madame Arnaud had to be satisfied with making the wolves howl and the raindrops jump on her cheap violin. They played in the orchestra at the Paris Hippodrome and counted every penny. When the riots began in June of 1848, the Arnauds had gone to the barricades and asked Major Wallin to look after their daughter, if anything should happen to them. Pierrette, who was 15 at the time, believed fervently in the cause as her parents explained it to her. Everyone should have the right to work so that they could feed themselves and their children. Not starving to death seemed the very least anyone could ask. She would have fought for it herself, but her parents told her to stay with Major Wallin, to look after him and Tilly. Her parents were killed by police fire at the barricade on the Rue Soufflot and buried in an unmarked grave. Pierrette decided that not starving was too little to ask for from the world after all. Major Wallin had left Paris with the Aurora troupe, selling their horses and buying new ones in England. They'd played for a few months in Brighton, travelled to Manchester for 3 nights only, then spent months with no work at all. Then at last they got word of the new hippodrome going up next to the Great Exhibition, and the world seemed brighter. A week after the Mazeppa debacle, Pierrette received an invitation to a soiree at No. 6 Great Cumberland Place. She was not very sure what one wore to a soiree in a grand house in London, but Jovita said she was clearly being asked because of who she was, and so there was no point in being anyone else. Armed with that logic and a yellow silk dress borrowed from Nell, Pierrette walked through the park once more. The house was tall and terrifying. A butler opened the door, taking her coat and hat. There was a room full of people, all of whom looked more comfortable than Pierrette felt. But there was Lady Lovelace, smiling at her. She sat Pierrette down and told her again that she must call her Ada. Her dark hair was parted on either side of her face, with dark ribbons tying it up, and she wore a simple, loose dress with a flowered border at the collar. "Do you know," Ada confided, leaning on the arm of her chair, "I completely forgot to ask your name the other night, and the newspaper didn't print it, so I had to send someone to find out. It's quite terrible, of course, what they wrote about your performance. It was a triumph, and would have been recognised as such if it hadn't been for me." Pierrette couldn't quite disagree with this. "But are you safe from your pursuers now?" she asked softly. Ada winced.
"There is no longer any danger. They won't hurt me. I've given him what he wants. One doesn't always have a choice."
As Pierrette tried to decide how to respond to this, or to ask who "him" referred to, Ada took her arm. Her host had a feverish look in her dark eyes.
"I've decided that the world must know, must understand how important your work is. We are coming into an age in which all the old snobbery must break down, and what was considered mere entertainment will be understood as art, and as science, for that matter. It's all one, if you ask me. Come and meet Mr. Ruskin."
John Ruskin was a man of about 30, with fine sideburns and a rather red nose, lounging by the unlit fireplace with a glass of port in his hand, and talking with several other gentlemen.
"Ruskin,"
said Ada briskly, addressing him by surname only in a very manly fashion.
"This is Pierrette Arnaud, an equestrian whose performance I had the good fortune to see. It combines a mastery of angles and velocity with a grasp of the sublime. Never before have I seen anything like it. It reminded me of music."
"I shall have to witness it," Ruskin said politely.
"But more than that," Ada went on, "her art must be painted. Your opinion is respected. Your reviews are courted. It is you, and only you, who can establish the equestrian as a suitable subject for painting."
"Oh, I don't know about only me," Ruskin said with a self-deprecating laugh. But after that, everything changed. Although the search for the rescued lady died down, the crowds at the Hippodrome were fuller than ever. They included several young men with sketchbooks, because word had spread from Ruskin to his artist friends, and they all wanted to capture the remarkable form and movement of Miss Pierrette Arnaud. A letter from Ruskin even appeared in the Times about the shifting ideal of the muse, mentioning her by name. Major Wallen separated her act from Jovita's, which Jovita didn't mind at all, as she said with a smile that she'd rather warm up the crowd than be upstaged.
"God knows I don't want to be famous," Jovita said with a laugh, "and I certainly don't want any drawings of me in the newspapers." But Pierrette did want to be famous, desperately, and she could finally glimpse it.
Pierrette had 3 proposals of marriage that summer, including one very persistent and unwelcome suitor, who ultimately had to be run off at the point of Major Warlin's rifle. She became a regular guest at the house on Great Cumberland Street, and sometimes it was only her alone with Ada. At others, though, Ada's friends were there. Some of them smiled at Pierrette's accent, but she didn't care. She met scientists and philanthropists and various dissipated cousins. She met some of Ruskin's protégés, including several alarming young artists and their models. She liked Lizzie Siddle, who seemed as out of her depth as Pierrette felt. She'd been a girl in a hat shop before one of Ruskin's painters had decided that she would make a good artist's model. She didn't much like the modelling, Lizzie said, but she was learning how to write and paint and draw, so it had turned out to be a good bargain in the end. Everyone in Ada's circles seemed to be bargaining for something, with someone. And sometimes, when Pierrette came to the house at the appointed time, Ada's formidable mother, Lady Byron, told her Ada was indisposed. It was the truth. Ada had always suffered from poor health, but that summer she was in constant pain, clutching her side and grimacing when she thought no one was looking. She had become somewhat gaunt and ate very little. At the end of July, Ada invited Pierrette out to her country house in Surrey to watch the imminent eclipse of the sun. Major Wallen assured her she should go, that absence would make the audience's heart grow fonder, so long as it was no more than 3 days. So Pierrette said yes. Ada even sent a carriage, and Pierrette felt like a girl in a fairy story when it drove into a courtyard dominated by turrets and ivy-covered walls. This was Horsley Towers, a seemingly never-ending building project that kept Ada's husband busy. Pierrette had never seen anything like it. It was surrounded by thick woods dotted with tracks, little bridges, and unusual grottos and shelters. Inside the enormous great hall, a portrait of Lord Byron in Albanian dress stared down at them.
"When I was a girl, that painting had a green velvet cloth covering it at all times," Ada confided as they sat, petting one of the house's dogs. "I never knew my father. He left England when I was a baby and died when I was 8. The great poet. Really, I think I must be very like him. I have a terrible imagination and it often gets me into trouble.
They watched the solar eclipse from a tower room that Ada's husband had built especially for her to explore her scientific studies. There were piles of notebooks and dusty old treatises lying everywhere, and Ada confided that she spent hours in this room writing letters and chuckling to herself. She corresponded with every great scientist in Europe, she said, and some of the bad ones too. She showed Pierrette all of her papers. She was most proud of her published commentary on Charles Babbage's design for something called an analytical engine. One evening, she talked excitedly about how the engine could solve any problem that humans could imagine using punched cards and rotating drums.
But where is it, this engine? Pierrette asked, frowning.
Oh, it's never been built, Ada said, as though that were unimportant.
Pierrette was as dazzled by Ada's talents as Ada was by hers, but sometimes she wondered what it was all for. The world was full of problems, and if a machine could solve them, why not build it?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.